So as you know, thought leadership is where we invite leaders who inspire us to make visions a reality and to turn and inspire others. And Michael Cary is one of those inspirational, trusted leaders. He is the curator of New York's Gagosian Gallery, has been, done that since 2008. He has, at the Gagosian, done many curatorial and publication projects, including Manzoni, a retrospective, Manzoni Asima, did I say that correctly? Francis Bacon, the late paintings, and numerous Picasso exhibitions. Before that, he spent 6 years in the painting and sculpture department at the Museum of Modern Art in New York. At MoCA, he worked on acquisitions and installations of the collection and the exhibitions Edvard Munch, The Modern Life of the Soul, and Richard Serra's Sculpture, 40 years. He advises museums throughout Europe and the United States, and he is a graduate of the School of the Institute, Art Institute of Chicago, where he studied painting. We at Lesley are incredibly lucky to have him here. So I thank you all for joining us. And Michael, we're so delighted that you're with us and sharing your expertise. Thank you.
Hi. Thank you all for having me. It is terrifying to be here. I have never done anything like this. I've never spoken about my work or what I do or why I do it or how I do it. Today I'm going to think about how I ended up doing it and maybe tell you a little bit about that. But I love speaking to students, and so when I was asked, I kind of had to say yes. I brought slides. I wrote it all down. We're all in this together. We're going to give it a try. I am employed as a Picasso expert, I suppose. That seems to be what I do for a living. There are no rules to expertise in Picasso. I have been issued no credentials in that field because there aren't any. I've done 11 Picasso exhibitions in the past 15 years. I work with members of the Picasso family. I consult with museums all over the world on their Picasso projects. It's a weird gig, but somebody's got to do it. I'm not an academic. I went to art school. I was a painter in college. I studied at the Art Institute of Chicago. And so I learned about painting from painters and from trying to do it. After graduating, I moved to New York. My rent was went from $235 a month in Chicago to $1,200 a month in Brooklyn. So I took a job to pay the rent and began the journey of trying to find a job in the art world. This was in the days when you circled the ads in the back of the Village Voice and then went to the post office and faxed your resume to them.
So fret and not get pressed. I didn't press the button.
Maybe it hasn't switched. I sent out 100 resumes in that first year, and I got 4 callbacks for interviews. I didn't get any of those jobs. I was sure that there was something wrong with me. I was about to give up, and then MoMA called. And MoMA was just another one of those 100 resumes I sent out. I interviewed up the chain of command. And my first gig in the art world in New York City was as the assistant to the chief curator of painting and sculpture at the Museum of Modern Art. I lucked out. Over 400 people applied for that job. Many, I'm assuming, were much more qualified than me. But when I finally met the chief curator for the final interview, he didn't ask me where I went to school. He didn't even ask me about what art I liked. We had a 20-minute conversation about opera, and I got the call the next day. I don't know if my slides are done. One of the jobs that I did while I was in Chicago at art school is that I worked backstage at the Lyric Opera. It is still my favorite job that I've ever had. I had the keys to the place, and on my way to the painting studios in the morning, I would go by and unlock all the doors. And then I'd go to school all day, and then at the end of the night, I would go back and I would see the performance, and I would be backstage, I would work the stage door, I would wait for everyone to leave, and then I'd lock up at the end of the night. I met all the greatest singers of the day. I sometimes walked their dogs. When I was a kid, opera was something that was on PBS, and when I came across it, I would turn the channel. I didn't know the first thing about opera, but by working there, I got an education that I otherwise would not have gotten. The chief curator of the Museum of Modern Art, Keniston McShine, was an opera fanatic. And that is what stood out to him on my resume. I always tell my interns to learn everything they can from every job that they do, because they cannot anticipate how that knowledge is going to play out later in life. So I approached my job at MoMA in a similar fashion, realizing that I could further my education there. It was a richer education than I could have hoped for. At MoMA, I learned how to do proper research, how to curate exhibitions, and the tricky and sometimes treacherous ethics of the art world. I learned about curating from curators, working beside them and amongst the best of them. And I had daily access to the greatest collection of 20th century art imaginable. The way MoMA was structured, there are curatorial assistants who are attached to exhibitions and assistants to curators who are attached to individuals. I was the latter, attached to Keniston, so anything that he worked on, all of his projects, I worked on as well. Acquisitions to the collection, installations of the permanent collection, in the galleries, and I worked on two exhibitions over 6 years, which kind of describes the pace at how MoMA moves. In 6 years, I did the Edvard Munch exhibition, and then the big Richard Serra sculpture exhibition in 2007. At the time, it was rare at the museum to have the opportunity to work with a living artist of Serra's stature. The gestation period of an exhibition project at MoMA is about 3 to 5 years. So I knew early on that if I stuck it out long enough, I would get to work with Serra. He was one of my favorite artists, and this was an opportunity to learn more, to immerse myself in his work. Through the course of working on that exhibition, I became close to Richard and his wife, Clara, and his whole studio team. When I decided to leave the museum, they suggested that I speak with Kogosi, which is Richard's gallery. I thought, I can't work for Larry Kogosi, doesn't matter. I don't know anything about the commercial art world. I'm gonna be useless there. But Richard said, Larry knows what he's talking about. Go talk to Larry. The gallery asked me what I wanted to do, and I said I wasn't sure, and I wasn't even sure if I really wanted to work there. They suggested I pick a desk, and then we'd figure something out. At the time, the gallery was planning two big museum-y type shows, and so since I was coming from a museum, they thought I could be useful. They asked me if I would like to work with Germano Celland, one of the most renowned curators in the world, the curator who coined the term Arte Povera. He curated the Venice Biennale, and he spent decades working at the Guggenheim. The gallery had employed Germano to curate the first exhibition, the first retrospective exhibition of Piero Manzoni ever in the US. I said, yes, please. We did that show, and the gallery asked me to hop onto their next big museum project, which was Picasso Mosqueteros, the first Picasso exhibition to be curated by John Richardson, Picasso's friend and biographer. Would that interest me? I said, yes, please. John and I hit it off. We became close friends. He became a mentor. He was 85 when we met. And we worked together until John passed away at 95 in 2019. We did 6 exhibitions together in those 10 years. John would choose the rough theme to explore. Together we would refine it into a more articulate thesis, do the research in the Picasso literature, and comb his body of work to build a checklist to support that thesis. But John was a biographer, a brilliant writer and a storyteller, but not a curator, not an experienced curator. As I had worked alongside and been trained, had a front row seat to some of the best curators around, we ended up being a good team. John was the guru, and I would deal with the nuts and bolts. There's a difference between what a curator does and what a decorator does. It's not a big difference, but the difference is significant. A decorator concerns themselves primarily with aesthetics, how objects look, and the feeling that they made it. They too deal in storytelling and juxtaposition and affect. But a curator always starts with what an artist is doing. The process and methods an artist employs in creating an object. That the object has an origin that is both physical and conceptual. And that is a crucial part of curatorial storytelling. The curator creates an exhibition to reveal what the artist was doing. In November of 2023, we opened our first Picasso exhibition at the gallery in New York that I've done without John. But again, I got to work with an outside scholar who is not a curator. Annie Cohen Solal is a sociologist and a biographer. She wrote a biography of Leo Castelli not too long ago. But she has written a book titled Picasso the Foreigner, which was published by FSG in April of last year. She published it in French, Picasso l'étranger, sometime in 2020. Annie's book, her research, focuses on Picasso's police record. Who knew Picasso had a police record? Well, almost nobody knew that Picasso had a police record until the 1990s. When the Nazis occupied Paris during World War II, they took the police archive with them to Berlin. When the Soviets defeated the Nazis, they took the archive to Moscow. So it wasn't until after the fall of the Soviet Union that the police archive was repatriated to France and scholars began to start to do their work. Picasso arrived in Paris for the first time in 1900. He was 19 years old. He had a painting in the Universal Exposition. And so he traveled to Paris to see the painting. He came back in 1901, he came back in 1902, he finally settled in Paris in 1904. When he arrived in 1901, he did what all immigrants and migrants do all over the world, all throughout history. He was 19 years old, he didn't know the language, he didn't know the city. So he sought out other Spaniards who had preceded him, other Spanish expats who had already settled in Mont. They gave him a community and a way into navigating a foreign city. Little did he know that those Spaniards who were living in Montmartre were all being watched by the police as suspected anarchists. So when Picasso arrives and he's hanging out with them, he gets charged with the same brush. And the first page of his police report is from 1901, saying he goes out at night, he comes home late, he's hanging out with these anarchists. He is an anarchist as well. This affected Picasso's life in a strange way. One of the things that Annie did was she looked at all of the records in the police, the correspondence in the Musée Picasso archives, in the National Archives, and sort of Picasso's friends and helpers and mentors, and sort of wove this grander narrative about Picasso's life as a foreigner and how foreigners navigate French society and French bureaucracy. Annie had her own sort of axe to grind. She was French, but French Algerian, and she grew up in Algeria, and she came to Paris as a teenager. And when she came to Paris as a teenager, she experienced some of that famous French chauvinism against foreigners. That very much informed her view of Picasso's life. The strange thing is that Picasso still, despite having a police record, despite never actually becoming a French citizen, he still became the most famous and respected and wealthiest and celebrated artist of the 20th century. In 1911, the Mona Lisa disappeared from the Louvre. Picasso was suspect number one because of this police record. The police arrived at his studio. They were going through the studio objects and they found other works of art that had been stolen from the Louvre. Now, y'all can go to the Louvre today and take your selfie with the Mona Lisa. Obviously, she was returned. But the crime remains unsolved. 1936, the Spanish Civil War starts. Picasso is living in Paris. 1937, he paints Garrick after the fascist Franco-Nazi bombing of that town. It's the grandest and greatest political painting of the 20th century. It becomes famous the world over. This paints a target on Picasso's back. Franco had already assassinated Federico Garcia Lorca. Picasso assumed he was next in line. He stays in Paris. He decides, okay, I can't go back to Spain because of Franco. I'm going to become a French citizen. He writes a letter to the immigration service, bestowing his presence on the nation, expecting to be welcomed with open arms. He is denied because of his police record. The policeman who writes the police, the report, denying his access to for citizenship, states that he is a suspected anarchist and has been an anarchist all along, despite the fact that he is a famous artist, but also that the policeman who wrote the police report himself was a Sunday painter, and he would go out and make landscapes on the weekends, and he didn't like Picasso's art. And so therefore, Picasso was rejected on two counts. He's denied French citizenship. After the war, he joins the Communist Party. He joins the Communist Party because the French have rejected him, the Spaniards have rejected him. Gives him a home. He later on in the 50s is offered the Légion d'honneur. He denies it. He dies in 1973, a Spaniard in Spain. So this is not a narrative about Picasso's work, right? It's a narrative about politics and archives and strategies. And yet we worked with Annie to figure out how do we make that into an exhibition. Right, because an exhibition is paintings on a wall. Annie's book is 900 pages. there's no way to put 900 pages on a wall. So one of the fascinating things about working with people who are not curators is trying to turn their ideas into exhibitions. We ended up having a really good time doing the show. I originally passed on this idea. Annie was persistent, I was proved wrong, and we've actually done one of the best shows that we've done. We brought in a co-curator, Varan Tissot. Varan Tissot is an art historian. We worked a moment together 1,000 years ago. She worked for the Musée Picasso. She works for the Picasso administration. She's a Picasso expert. She's also a Kahnweiler expert. Another part of Picasso's troubles as a foreigner in France. Picasso paints the Demoiselle d'Avignon in 1907. He shows it to his friends. His friends laugh at him. They think he's gone crazy. They think he's taking the wrong path. There was a young enterprising banker named Daniel Henry Kahnweiler who worked at the Bourse, and he loved art, and he would walk over to the Louvre in the afternoons to look at paintings. He grew sick of finance, decided to open a gallery. He opens a gallery, and someone said to him in July of 1907, you should go check out this kid Picasso. He visits Picasso's studio. He encounters the Demoiselle d'Avignon, and history is made. Daniel Henry Kahnweiler thinks it is the greatest thing he's ever seen. It was difficult, it was monstrous, but fascinating. He works on Picasso and eventually convinces Picasso to sign on and let him represent him exclusively. Kahnweiler is the one who, through his network of dealers throughout the rest of Europe, evangelizes Cubism. It makes Cubism a thing. World War I happens. Kahnweiler is a German national living in the French capital. The contents of his gallery is confiscated by the French state as enemy assets, including 300 works by Picasso. Because Picasso and Kahnweiler are not French citizens, they have no legal standing to get those works back. They try and they try and they try and they fail. The French government then auctions off the contents in a series of auctions in the early 1920s. How do you dramatize this as a as an exhibition on the wall? Kahnweiler had it rough because in World War II, he was a German and Jewish living in Paris. He had to Aryanize his gallery, he lost everything again, but he put it in the name of his French stepdaughter, and so it worked out. But how do you show this as an exhibition? One of the things we did was that we tracked down all of the works that we could find that were part of that site, right? The works that were auctioned off. We got two of them for the exhibition. One of them is a painting in the Philadelphia Museum. One is in a private collection. But one of the ones that we got, the one that's in a private collection, very small painting, it had been misidentified in the literature over the years as being a collage because there is a little tiny piece of pasted paper in the corner. That piece of paper, we figured out, Varan, the co-curator, who's the Conviler expert, realized that that is a sticker with a lot number from the auction in 1921. The paintings were thought so worthless that the auction house put the stickers right on the face of the painting. Now, of course, over the years, all of these works are masterpieces, and so conservators have removed those stickers, but somehow this one survived. So that is part of the way that we kind of turn political ideas in a book into pictures on a wall. Of course, I would have to be standing next to that picture and explaining to you that that sticker was the auction number, but it'll be in the catalog, it'll be fun. Again, because the story didn't have a direct link to Picasso's work, it actually allowed us to do almost a full retrospective. The earliest painting we have in the show is from when Picasso was 15 years old and he painted it in 1896. And we have Picasso's last painting, painted in July of 1972, also in the show. We have five loans from MoMA, four loans from the Met, two loans from Philadelphia. It's a very well-supported show. It is up in New York City until February 10th, in case any of you can come down. But Annie, working with Annie confirmed my love of sort of working with non-curators on curatorial projects. I've ended up very much a curatorial midwife, working behind the scenes. This is all to say that my career developed without a plan, without a strategy other than to stay flexible and say yes and learn everything that I can. We all learn lessons from everything we do, right? It's always valuable, sometimes positive, sometimes negative. Sometimes we say yes, but we should really say no. But I have found that staying open to it all is the key. Maybe saying sure instead of saying yes, but staying fluid. I turned 18 and began my undergraduate journey in 1993. I am a member of Gen X, which is the most beautiful generation of humans to ever live. The proud slackers of we were the last generation in the United States to live a naturally temporal life. We grew up before the internet.
Yes.
We had no virtual world to try and navigate. We had no virtual selves, no smartphones, just each other, face to face. About labels, we were defiant. Nobody's going to label me. I'm unique, I'm unclassifiable. Even in art school, we would never say we were artists. We would never say we were a painter or a sculptor. We did things. I make paintings. I make performances. I make pieces. I'm saying this here today because we're at a university where young minds are hard at work trying to figure themselves out. But it's also because I worry about their efforts. I worry about the tendency in contemporary life to feel the need to label and define oneself, to define one's identity to the nth degree, the urge to make oneself a brand, to articulate your intersectionality. There are dangers to calcifying yourself, and I worry that young folks today feel pressured to answer for who they are. And this, strangely enough, brings me back to Picasso. A really prolific artist might make 5,000 works in their lifetime. Picasso made 25,000. He is the most written about artist in history and the most studied of the 20th century. But it's not only the imagery that Picasso Picasso created that sustains our interest. His images, arguably, fail to be consistently interesting, though every last one is essential to the puzzle. There's something about Picasso's behavior as an artist that fascinates us. The way Meyer Shapiro put it is, quote, there exists in his practice a radical change with respect to the very concept of working, of production. Perhaps method is a better word. The method of working that Picasso developed from his earliest student days was not just unconventional, but an unforeseen challenge to the whole enterprise of making, showing, critiquing, and selling art. The process that Picasso develops is at once intensely personal and personality-less, identity-less. Embracing both youthful anxiety and his natural talents, he conceives of his practice and his role in it as something of a cipher, conjugating images and influences into highly sophisticated forms. Art students preoccupy themselves with mastering style, trying on different guises and experimenting in different directions to find or develop a signature style that fits them. If they can develop a style that is unique to them and practice it consistently, all the better, as it will help to differentiate themselves from their peers. In a letter Picasso wrote to a friend in 1897 while studying in Madrid, he writes, quote, I don't believe in following any particular school, for all it leads to is mannerism and affectation in the painters who do it. Picasso doesn't want to hitch his wagon to one school or style. Why limit himself? Narrowly defining what or who one is presents the danger of eliminating everything one could be. Picasso short circuits the art student's formula and adopts no style as his signature. It's brave and brazen, flaunting imitation and denying the value of authenticity. This is his brand. His natural talents and training provided him virtuosity in both mimicry and improvisation. And rather than copying, he adopts the language and visual style of other painters to create original works of his own. Picasso can impersonate the style of any artist, but he does so by poking fun, challenging, ironic parody, one-upmanship. It allows him both anonymity, like an actor disappearing into his roles, but also the audacity of his performance. Picasso scholar Elizabeth Cowling points out that Picasso's strategy of matching an adopted style with a subject, and thus he paints a portrait of his crazy Aunt Peppa in the style of Velázquez's Buffoon. He paints a portrait of the morose and languid, long-faced Aniello de Soto in the style of El Greco. Parisian cityscapes like Pizarro, cafe scenes like Toulouse-Lautrec. Picasso continues this zigzagging strategy from Barcelona to Paris and back in the run-up to his first exhibition in Paris with Ambroise Vollard in 1901. He was 20 years old. He badly needed to attract clients and to sell, but above all, he was determined to get noticed. Hence, his strategy was to have a go at every likely subject and brashly showing off. The critics voiced disapproval at his eclecticism and hasty technique, but being labeled a phenomenon was excellent publicity. This strategy or method or concept of working presents the typical Picassian paradox, a chimera-like obscuring of identity in order to attract more attention. In his review of that first show with Vollard in 1901, the critic Felician Fagus wrote, quote, one can easily discern numerous probable influences, each is fleeting, no sooner caught than dropped, His surge forward has not left him the leisure to forge a personal style yet. His personality is embodied in this hastiness, this youthful, impetuous spontaneity. The danger for him lies in this very impetuousness, which could so easily lead to facile virtuosity and easy success. Fagus sees this impetuous trying out too many things too quickly as a consequence of Picasso's youth and immaturity, even titling his review cheekily The Spanish Invasion, as if Picasso was waging a pitched battle. Correct on all counts. What the critics of that first show failed to consider was that this impetuous eclecticism was on purpose. The show is both a demonstration of the method Picasso had devised for working with no style and the birth of its market value. Being a young and unknown painter, it was cheaper for collectors to acquire a Picasso than a Toulouse-Lautrec. And perhaps compared to El Greco. Nothing succeeds like success, and the attention the show captured, let alone sales, proved that Picasso's strategy worked. What is entirely unknowable, however, is how this strategy was dictated by, as Fagus suggests, Picasso's personality. Quote, it's through one's work that one is understood, Picasso told his dealer, Kahnweiler, in 1955. But what does he mean by understood? Can we understand or discern a painter's personality through facture, composition, subject matter, or style? Especially if those elements are in some way borrowed or shared from someone else. Work is also a verb. And perhaps there is a double meaning here to keep in mind. Not only through one's works, but through one's working method. Quote, Picasso again. What does it mean for a painter to paint in the manner of so-and-so? Or to actually imitate someone else. What's wrong with that? On the contrary, it's a good idea. You should constantly try to paint like someone else. But the thing is, you can't. You would like to, you try, but it turns out to be a botch. And it's at that very moment where you make a botch of it that you are yourself. For Picasso, it's in the botch, the failure, showing vulnerability and anxiety, that the painter is most truly himself. Picasso made a habit of this kind of failed imitation throughout his career, the failure being an essential tool in his method. Chasing after the masters in his personal pantheon, Velázquez, El Greco, Ingres, Delacroix, Manet, Degas, he refreshes his eye and opens new paths again and again. In the 1950s, he created what Richardson called Picassified versions of the old master's compositions. In a sense, giving Velázquez's Las Meninas or Delacroix's Femme d'Alger the personality of a Picasso. Writers such as John Berger and Rosalind Krauss discuss much of this tendency of Picasso's method to be facile pastiche. There is a fascinating tension between impersonating another artist's style and imposing his own persona or identity on another artist's compositions or subjects. These Picassos test just how close to failure he can get, assessing how he measures up to the masters, proving his prodigious talent, challenging and bettering his followers. His performance is the element that is most consistent across his oeuvre, one notable exception, the most radical break in representation in the history of art, Cubism. The height of Cubism's assault on the very nature of likeness arrives as Picasso is nearing 30 years old. That is, at the end of what might be considered his youth. It seems perhaps an apt metaphor. As Picasso has spent so much of his youth making a name for himself by disappearing into his method, preventing any likeness of himself as an artist from becoming two-faced. What we end up with is, in Shapira's description, quote, "The artist not only as an acclaimed performer or a man of achievement, but also as one who is attentive to his own art, who is studying, investigating the process of art, one who wants to show his true strength as that of an artist who can build, manipulate, apportion, who knows the rightness of every element within the whole in an architectural sense." So rather than a fixed likeness of Picasso, we have a performance, an accumulation of behaviors and viewpoints, the architecture of a personality, details jumbled together, contradicting one another, that just barely begin to coalesce into the faceted portrait of the artist as a young man. A cubist portrait is certainly alive, but more as a fabrication, not necessarily as a likeness. The strange thing is that Picasso confessed that he created his work as one would a diary. Not every work is so, but every work is meticulously dated. Picasso didn't fabricate, he documented. His harlequins and minotaurs are avatars, depicted interacting with portraits of actual friends and lovers. He painted the people he knew, the circumstances of their lives, the views out his very own windows. Picasso created many likenesses of the women in his life, Fernand, Olga, Marie-Thérèse, Dora Maar, over the course of their respective relationships, some more realist, other more abstracted, with varying degrees of faithfulness. But one can never really know what goes on in the intimate relations between two people from the outside, and certainly not from the application of colored mud to a piece of fabric. John Richardson, Picasso's biographer, should know. He said, "We should remember that diaries are nonetheless interesting for fantasizing, embroidering, and reordering the truth." Quote, "The inner I is inevitable in my painting, since it is I who make it. I needn't worry about that," Picasso told a friend. "Whatever I do, it will be there. It will be all too much there." But for Picasso, that inner I is a method, not an identity. There's an iconographic sequence that spans nearly Picasso's entire career. The image of a woman arranging her hair. The coiffure is about identity. Changing a look. Arranging yourself in the mirror in a way that pleases you. Creating a likeness of yourself. As you imagine you should look, it pushes a stray detail out of the way, getting your hair out of your eyes, out of the way of a child's grasping hand, preparing yourself to dance. It is also an intimate gesture, something practiced and repeated in second nature. It's an act of fixing, both correcting something and staying something in place. It describes a personality, both visually, creating a certain specific appearance, but by revealing the unthought automatic gestures that are particular to a certain person, their hands, their locks, their countenance. The hair is also something sensual and sexy and intimate, pleasurable and private. Picasso steals the subject from Degas and conjugates it through every style and every period and with every muse. The method of wildly shifting styles to obscure identity that Picasso developed as a signature in youth and carried through his life is the narrative he intended, and he meant us to experience his work in this complicated, unpin-downable way. There's so much stylistic experimentation and variety in Picasso's oeuvre that an exhibition of his work can often appear to be, or mistaken for, a group show. That is not only true now in academic hindsight or curatorial insight. It was true in that first exhibition in 1901 as well. It was also true when Picasso himself hung his 1932 retrospective at the Galerie Georges Petit in Paris. Quote, Somebody asked me how I was going to arrange my exhibition, Picasso told a friend, shortly after the retrospective's opening. I answered badly, because an exhibition, like a picture, well or badly arranged, means the same thing. That which counts is the spirit of continuity of ideas. Nearer the end of Picasso's life, at the age of 85, he embarked on yet another unforeseen body of work. Satirical, boyish, cheekier than ever. The canvases were loosely, hastily painted, daringly impetuous. He steals from Rembrandt, Hals, Goya, poking fun at their matadors and musketeers. It is a final act that honors the method he practiced not only in youth, but all along. Picasso grew old, but thankfully he never grew up.